Good morning. Welcome to the Crossing Baptist Church. Here at the Crossing, our mission is sharing Christ, equipping believers, and serving people. If you'd like more information about the Crossing, or if you have a prayer request, please email us at contact@crossingbaptist.org. Please visit our website and join our Facebook page. Our service is about to start momentarily. So have a blessed day and hope to see you soon.
see. Open up the heaven, we want to see you. Open up the floodgate, Almighty River, pouring out your heart and filling every part of our prayer. Like a cloud, you're standing with us now. The world long belongs. You're the wisdom we hear. You're the wisdom we see. Open up the heaven, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, Almighty River, flowing on your heart. And feeling every part of our praise. Open up the heavens, we want to see you. Open up the floodgates, Almighty River, flowing on the heart. And feeling every part of our praise.
Glory, show us your power, show us your glory, Lord. Show us your glory, show us your power, show us your glory.
Underneath the seat in front of you, and you can drop it in the offering plate that is at the plate box that's at the back of the sanctuary. We'd also like to welcome any visitors online. Please let us know that you're joining us by leaving some comments in the comment section, and just turn around. I would recommend turning around and just greeting everybody at this time. Social distance.
All right, well, you can be seated. Kiddos, we don't have a children's lesson today because our pastor is on vacation. So I'm sorry, but you guys pay close attention when Eric Black comes to speak a little bit later, and we will, I'm sure you'll be able to get something from that message as well. Let's just continue to sing today, all right? Here we go.
Jesus,
found a resting place. My faith has found a resting place. Now in the vital creed, I trust the ever-living one, whose wounds for me shall bleed. I need no other argument, I need no other plea. It is enough that Jesus died, and that he died for me.
Verses 12 through 17. Thank you for standing. Teach us to number our days, that we may gain a heart of wisdom. Relent, Lord, how long will it be? Have compassion on your servants. Satisfy us in the morning with your unfailing love, that we may sing for joy and be glad all our days. Make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, as for many years as we have seen trouble. May your deeds be shown to your servants, your splendor to your children. May the favor of the Lord our God rest on us. Establish the work of our hands for us. Yes, establish the work of our hands.
For
Prayer today and all we do, that we honor you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning. It's always a joy to come up here so I can see who's all at church today. See all these pretty faces. Thanks for that worship this morning, worship team. As we all know, our pastor and his families are vacationing this weekend, so today we've been blessed with a guest speaker. And that guest speaker is Mr. Eric Black. Eric is the executive director and publisher and editor, at the Baptist Standard. And when I talked to him earlier, he said, yeah, that's a very long title. And I said, well, that must mean you're very important. And he said, no, it just means I have a lot of responsibility. So I will say also, somebody came up to me and say, is he from the Baptist Standard? I say, yes, he is. So you at least have one fan here today, Mr. Black. Just want to let you know. So Eric came to the Baptist Standard with a background in local church ministry, both in the pastorate and the youth ministry, as well as the collegiate ministry and Christian education. He was licensed to the gospel by Hoffmantown Baptist Church in Albuquerque, New Mexico, and ordained by Acton Baptist Church in Granbury. He earned his bachelor's degree from Hardin-Simmons University, a Master of Arts in Christian Education degree from Southwest Baptist Theological Seminary, and a Doctor of Philosophy degree from B.H. Carroll Theological Institute. He was a pastor of First Baptist Church in Covington from 2010 to 2018. Previously, he was the associate pastor of youth ministries at First Baptist Church in Galax, Virginia, and the Associate Director of Grace Life Baptist Student Union at the University of New Mexico in Albuquerque. So he's been around for a while. In addition to his service as a pastor, he's also a resident fellow at the B.H. Carroll Theological Institute from 2008 to 2018, teaching philosophy of Christian education. He and his wife, Delise, have two children, Alan and Caroline. So without further ado, I'd like you to welcome Mr. Eric Black.
It's a little strange to have that kind of an introduction because when I was a pastor, I didn't have somebody getting up in front, ahead of me every Sunday morning and telling everybody who I was. So I will try to live into the description. First, I want to say what an honor it is to get to be here this morning and to preach in your pastor's stead. Patrick has been a friend of mine. He's a good friend, and I appreciate him entrusting me to preach while he's away. And also, I want to say thank you to you for allowing your pastor, giving him and his family time to rest. As you all know, it's nice to get a rest every once in a while. And the last couple of years for pastors have been extraordinarily difficult. And I can tell you, having been a pastor, that he appreciates the time. It will serve him and his family well, and in turn, it will serve you well. Thank you for letting him do that. This morning, we are going to look at three words. But as every pastor can do, we are going to spend a long time talking about just three words. But those three words are in 1 Corinthians 13. So if you want to turn there or if you want to follow along on the screen, we'll actually read the passage in just a little bit. But those three words are love always perseveres. Three simple words, but they are packed with meaning, especially when you put them together. But before we talk about those three words, I want to tell you a little bit about what I've learned of pearl diving. Now, some of you may know about pearl diving. I don't know. I didn't know a whole lot about it until just recently, but I learned recently that pearls, for centuries, were worth more than diamonds. I don't know if you knew that. I didn't know that. Well, as it turns out, part of the explanation for their value is their rarity and the difficulty in collecting them. Japanese ama, that's the name for traditional pearl divers in Japan, and traditional pearl divers around the east coast of Africa and around the Arabian Peninsula have been diving for pearls for thousands of years, which means that they've been diving for pearls without scuba equipment, air tanks. Yeah. And to do what they do, they have to be able to hold their breath for up to 2 minutes as deep as 125 feet underwater. Now, most dives don't go much further than 40 feet. This isn't even 40 feet. Can you imagine? If you've ever dove to the bottom of a 6 or 8 foot pool, you know what that feels like and how you have to hold your breath for just a few seconds and what it does to your ears. So for traditional pearl divers to do what they do, and by the way, around Dubai, at the Arabian Peninsula, the pearl divers there will make as many as 200 dives in a day. So to do that, they have to learn specific ways of breathing. And they have to learn how to regulate the pressure in their ears. Around Dubai, the pearl divers there, because they make so many dives in a day so that they don't wear themselves out going up and down in the water, they have a weight tied to them. And when they drop the weight, it takes them down to the floor. When they find an oyster or two or three, and they put that in the basket that they have around their neck, then they tug on a rope that's going up to the boat above them, and there's someone in the boat, hopefully who's awake, and feels that tug and pulls them out of the water. It's extraordinary. Now, in some places, like around Dubai, what I saw, the water was pretty murky. I don't know how in the world they saw anything, much less an oyster on the floor. In other places, like Japan, where there's a lot of wave activity, they risk dangerous waves. And just about everywhere that traditional pearl divers work, they face sharks, some of whom have attacked humans. They face jellyfish, some of which are not just poisonous, but deadly poisonous. They face sea snakes, which are very poisonous. And also there's these stonefish, which not only are poisonous and very poisonous, but they're camouflaged on the floor where the oysters are. These divers face all of this in addition to hypothermia, if they're in cold water too long, hyperventilation, if they don't breathe right or if they come up too fast, loss of consciousness, eye, ear, and brain damage, heart attacks, and of course, drowning. And yet, despite all of that, they keep doing it. Have you ever felt, and maybe you feel today, like you are 40 feet underwater? Surrounded by danger, and everybody's telling you, just hold your breath. Yeah. Or maybe they say, hang in there. Just hold your breath. And maybe you think, what choice do I have? I'm down here, surrounded by what can kill me, and life is up there, if I can get there. And maybe to hear, just hold your breath, only adds more pressure. Now get this. Traditional pearl divers around the Arabian Peninsula, their success rate is 1 in 100. That means for every 100 oysters they bring up, there's one pearl. Oh, but it gets better. For every 10 pearls they find, so that's about 1,000 oysters, for every 10 pearls they find, one of them is sizable, like you might put on a necklace. Despite the dismal success rate, despite all the dangers, and despite the pretty stiff competition from pearl farms that have a much higher success rate and less danger, despite all of that, traditional pearl divers keep doing it. A Japanese ama said that when she finds something, she is overjoyed. She also said this, once you feel that level of emotion, even just once, it's impossible to want to stop. Love always perseveres. But that's a different kind of love, and that love's object is a different kind of thing from what Paul is talking about in 1 Corinthians 13. So if we are to find any good news at all in what Paul is talking about, we need to know what he meant when he said, love always perseveres. So what did Paul mean? Well, the first thing we can be sure that Paul meant, he wasn't being merely poetic. He wasn't writing something that we would have 2,000 years later to read at wedding ceremonies to make us feel good. Paul wasn't talking about how love feels. Paul was describing the very essence of love, its nature, its character, its substance. So, what is the essence of the love that Paul is describing? Well, here again, it's important to know that the word Paul uses for love, see, in English, we have this one word love, and you already know this probably, that one word love is asked to do a lot of work. Paul uses the word agape, which has a specific kind of meaning. Now, it helps us to understand how important agape is versus other kinds of love when we know that in Greek there are several words for love. There's eros, phileo, not like phileo fish, phileo like Philadelphia, and storge. Now, those three kinds of loves are transactional. They're dependent on the object of that love doing something for the person loving. Eros is a desiring kind of love. So when something makes you feel good, or when someone makes you feel good, you want that thing or that person, you desire them. It's fickle. It's really based on emotion, really. Phileo love, this friendship kind of love, is based on shared circumstances and proximity. We tend to be friends with people who are near us more so than people who are far away, unless we're on Facebook, and then we can be friends with a million people wherever they happen to live, right? No, we all know that real friendship is based on you do something to help me, I do something to help you. It's a cultivated relationship. It's dependent on being close. Storge is a parental kind of love, and we might say as parents, oh, that's a good kind of love. That's a sturdy, steady kind of love. Well, yeah, it's a good love. All these loves have their place. Storge, however, is dependent. It's an obligated kind of love. It's dependent on an object, number one. But, you know, we hope that what we do, what we give to our children is appreciated and that they grow up to do something good with it. And maybe we even hope that our children someday will appreciate our love for them so much that when we need it, they will take care of us. There is kind of a transactional dependency in this love as well. But agape, is very different. Let's talk about agape. Because you see, in 1 Corinthians 13, every time you see the word love in English, it's not just any kind of love, it's agape. Biblical scholars define agape as love which chooses its object. In other words, the lover, the one in the driver's seat, chooses this object of love regardless of anything that object can or will do. It's not an earned love. It's a given love, a freely chosen gift. So we might also describe it as preferential love, or as self-sacrificing, self-emptying love, because it's always one-directional. It's going out regardless of whether anything comes back. It is a seeking the welfare of another, even if that other never does anything in return. This is the kind of love Paul is talking about, always persevering. He never describes any other kind of love in the way that he describes agape. Well, so to fully understand agape, we need to know where it comes from. Is it something that we manufacture in ourselves? Do we sort of gin it up or work it up in ourselves? Or does it come from somewhere else? Here's where we get to the good news of agape. Because you see, agape, that kind of love, originates in God. And it is embodied in the person of Jesus Christ. Jesus is God's always persevering love in flesh and blood. Now, let's step back from this for a moment. And let's remember that in John chapter 10, Jesus said, I and the Father, God the Father, are one. Okay, so let's hold that here. And then a little bit later in another letter that John wrote, John says, God is love. So if Jesus and God the Father are one, and if God is love, then we can say Jesus is love. All right. So now, let's go to 1 Corinthians 13, and let's read Paul's description of love, and rather than reading the word love, let's substitute the name Jesus. So if we start in verse 4, we read, Jesus is patient. Jesus is kind. Jesus does not envy. Jesus does not boast and is not proud. Jesus does not dishonor others and is not self-seeking and is not easily angered. Jesus keeps no record of wrongs. Oh, that's good news all by itself. Jesus does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. Jesus always protects, always trusts, always hopes, always perseveres. Jesus never fails. Jesus always perseveres. Our love can't always persevere. Even the good kind of love, what we would call the good kind of love, the phileo or the friendship kind of love, or the storge, the parental kind of love, we would say we will love our children forever, but there's a sense in which, and there's a point at which, we just don't know. I mean, life gets hard. And we don't know if we can keep at it. We might not want to say that out loud, but we've certainly thought it or felt it. And really, our love that we have to work up and feel like doing or you know, just sort of suck it up and just, you know, that kind of love, it can't always persevere. It can't always hold up, and it won't always hold up. For 2 minutes under 40 feet of water. You know, over the last year and a half or so, we've felt like we've been under at least 40 feet of water, trying to hold our breath as long as possible until we get through this. And we've, some of us, reached a breaking point. Love always perseveres? Well, not our love. But God's love always can, always does, and always will. God's love always perseveres. But what's so important about perseverance anyway? Well, we have to look to Jesus to answer that question. In another letter that Paul wrote to the Christians in Rome, we've been looking at a letter that Paul wrote to the Christians in Corinth, but in this other letter, Paul wrote this, Romans 5:8. For God demonstrated His own love for us in this, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And do you know that that word love that Paul uses is agape? It's not just any kind of love. So, what kind of love did Jesus demonstrate? Agape. And how did Jesus demonstrate it? By dying for us. And not because we earned it. Not because we had done anything to receive that kind of benefit. No, Jesus died for us without us having done a thing. Well, actually, we had done something. We had been enemies of God. We were at our worst. We were still sinners. We were far away from God. Jesus died for us then. But Jesus was demonstrating agape long before that. Jesus demonstrated agape in specific ways all through His life and ministry. We're not going to survey His whole life. But let's go back to John. In the Gospel of John, chapter 13, this is the night that Jesus, His last evening night with His disciples. They're about to have a meal together. And John writes this, that Jesus, having loved His own who were in the world, loved them to the end. Guess what kind of love? Agape. And how did Jesus love them? Well, if you know the story, you know that He loved them by washing No, no, no. Not washing their feet. Washing their nasty feet. Nasty feet. By his own choice. He scandalized them by taking the lowest position in the room. He was supposed to be the highest in the room. He took the lowest position in the room. He chose to do that. Nobody told him to. And he cared for them. He washed their nasty feet. He fouled his own hands that he was about to eat with to make them clean. We could say an awful lot about that. But that's not all Jesus did to demonstrate agape. Later that night, they went to the garden and he agonized his impending execution. Said, Father, if there's any way out of this, I'll take it. I'd like for there to be a way out of this, but not my will, your will be done. And then he endured being arrested, being slandered and humiliated, being spit on, being beaten, having his hair and beard pulled out. He endured a mock trial the next day, being whipped, walked through town in utter humiliation, stripped of his clothes, nailed on a pole, and hung up to die. And he did die. Jesus endured all of that. When Paul says love endures all things, love always perseveres, my Lord. And Jesus had a choice. He didn't have to go through with any of that. Right up to the very end and all the way through, he had a choice. He could have called a legion of angels to save him at any moment. Wouldn't that have been spectacular? That probably would have made the Bible. But he didn't. Instead, he saved his breath to commit his spirit into God the Father's hands. And what did he say? It is finished. He didn't quit before it was finished. Oh, but you see, he didn't stay dead. Jesus' perseverance didn't end with death. Oh, he died, he was buried. He endured up to death, into death, through death, and out of death. And he rose to life and conquered sin and death. And he lives still and endures still. Jesus always perseveres. Our salvation, our being reconciled to God, depends on Jesus always persevering, not quitting too soon. There were certain points in there we would have said, Jesus, that's enough. That's what, you don't have to go any farther. I remember watching The Passion of the Christ, Mel Gibson's Passion of the Christ in the theater. And there was a certain point at which I was so overcome by the depiction of Jesus's beating. I was grabbing the arms. I've never been this emotionally involved in a movie before, and I was grabbing the arms of my chair, and I almost lost myself and stood up and said, that's enough! You see, there's a point at which you don't have to go any further, Jesus. Ah, but Jesus' love knows no end. Does our love always persevere? Does our love endure all things? No. But we're not talking about our love. We're talking about God's love, embodied in Jesus Christ and living in us through God's Spirit. But isn't our love supposed to always persevere? I mean, as Christians, aren't we supposed to persevere in love? Well, yes, if we're talking about God's love and not our own. But to do that, we have to remain in Christ. And this takes us back to the Gospel of John. This is on the same evening that Jesus was eating his last meal with his disciples. He had washed their feet. And Jesus said, this is in John chapter 15, "I am the true vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. But apart from me, you can do nothing." Surely that applies to our love. Oh, well, in fact, Jesus went on to say, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love." What love do you suppose that is? Agape. In the next sentence, Jesus told us that we remain in His love by keeping His commands. And two sentences after that, Jesus said, "You keep my commands when you love as I have loved you." Want to guess what kind of love that is? Agape. Yeah. It sounds like a rhetorical question because it's, I mean, we've just been beating that drum, haven't we? Agape. So are we to love? Oh, yes. Are we to love as Jesus loved us and loves us still? Oh, yes. Are we to keep on loving as Jesus loved? Yes. The Bible is very clear about that. In fact, we are commanded to love. And we're trying, aren't we? I mean, we're really glad Jesus always perseveres, but we're not Jesus. Help us, Lord. You've commanded us to do something we can't do. Well, now wait. But we really are trying to love like Jesus. And yet we're 40 feet underwater, and the air's running out. What are we going to do? To know God is love and that Jesus is God's love in flesh and blood and that God's love always perseveres, well, let's be honest. That sounds like good news for when you're still in the boat. But we're not in the boat. We're in the water. We need good news not only for when we're in the boat, but for when we're in the water. To mix our metaphors, what does love's perseverance look like when the rubber meets the road? In the nitty-gritty of life. As I was driving over this morning, on 635, you see all kinds of businesses for all kinds of things. And when you start to put it together, what you're seeing is all the things that people love, or the consequences that a person takes on in their life when they live in a certain kind of love. And we know that the nitty-gritty of life gets pretty nasty. I mean, the disciples' dirty, nasty feet don't hold a candle to some of the nastiness of life what in the world does it look like for love to persevere in that? Well, here again, we have some good news. Gordon Fee, a great Pauline and New Testament scholar, writes this in his commentary on 1 Corinthians 13. He writes, Paul doesn't mean that love always believes the best about everything and everyone. Whew. Don't we think that as Christians that we're not supposed to say bad things about someone else, even if it's true, that we're supposed to sugarcoat things and be nice? Is that love? Well, maybe it is and maybe it's not. But Paul doesn't mean that we have to just believe the best about everything and everyone, but that love never ceases to trust God and thus leave justice in God's hands. It is in this sense that love never loses hope, that God's justice in the context of God's goodness will yet prevail where there is human fallenness, even grotesque fallenness. That's what we're talking about, isn't it? What about when the grotesque fallenness is in me? What about when the grotesque fallenness is in one of my coworkers, or a friend at school, or a teacher at school, or in one of my family members, or a neighbor, or someone in our government, or, I mean, on and on and on. What then, when we depend on those people not to succumb to grotesque fallenness, right? Ah, well. He goes on to say, this is why love can endure. The life that is so touched by the never-ceasing love of God in Christ is in turn enabled by the Spirit to love others in the same way. Yes, Jesus commanded us to love as Jesus loved us. But Jesus didn't say you have to do that all on your own. And if you can't do it, well, too bad for you. No, Jesus commanded us to do what He did and does and gave us the Holy Spirit to make it possible. We just need to remain in Christ and in Christ's love. So yes, love always perseveres, but not because it's our love. It's not something we have to manufacture, work up in ourselves, but because it's God's love, lived for us in flesh and blood in Jesus Christ, who endured everything, even into death, through death, and out of death, and that lives in us in God's Spirit, which is also none of our doing. When I was a young boy, I went under the water in a swimming pool. I wasn't a strong swimmer yet. I vividly remember the bright sky above me and the gurgling sound in my ears as I was going down and the rippling surface of the water. I remember it was pretty. It was peaceful. And I remember the sudden appearance of a human form and an arm reaching into the water and grabbing me and pulling me hard and fast out of the water into the air. It was my dad. Today, you might think you're the diver. You're the pearl. And love, capital L love, Jesus, endured everything to find you and to redeem you You don't have to hold your breath anymore. You just need to let Him pull you out of the water. Patrick tells me this is the time of invitation when you have an opportunity to respond to what God has spoken to you this morning. Or maybe not just this morning, maybe it's been during the week or several weeks ago, and you're just now getting to the place where, okay, all right, I'll let you pull me out of the water. However you need to respond this morning, this is the time set aside during the worship service for you to do that. And I'll be at the front, and if you don't want to talk to me, I get it. That's okay. Patrick will be back. But there are others that you can talk to here this morning.
Let's stand and let's sing the song of commitment.
I've read that chapter several times, but I've never gotten that out of it. Thank you. In fact, I had two words, agape love, which is one-way love, not wanting anything in return, and phileo love, not to be confused with phileo fish. Even though I got a lot of pals that like phileo fish, it's that love that we just, uncomprehensible to us. All right. Let's go into our announcements for the upcoming week, which is today at our 6 o'clock, like we do every Sunday. Ms. Lourdes and her prayer team will be leading the prayer meeting, and that's just not for the prayer team. That's for anybody that wants to be a part of that ministry. Show up today at 6 o'clock. Wednesday evenings, we're going to have our Bible studies like we do every week for adults, youth, and children. They all start at 6:30, and I think they're done by 7:30, but we youth like to have a little fun, so we're here till 8. So if you have them here, just be prepared to hang out till 8 because we don't leave before 8. And Saturday, the 16th, we have our ministry council meeting that's coming up. And Friday, again, women's movie night will be happening. And then Sunday, the fall festival. And I think Ms. Kelly has sign up out front for anybody that's able to help with that or assist with that. Also, to be able to bring goodies for that as well also. There's a big box out front. We're going to need people and prizes and those good things as well also. And also save the date. November 20th is our church's 25th church celebration, as well as our missions banquet. So make yourself available for that. Before we leave, we have one last item on the agenda today. We're going to have Miss Debbie Chu come up and share something with us briefly, and then we'll sing our song of praise and we'll be dismissed.
Is that all?
No, come on up.
Mr. Black got a long introduction. Okay. So I guess you are important.
No biography for Debbie, sorry.
That's okay.
My apologies.
Let me find some glasses here. All right. As Mr. Bryan said, my name is Debbie Chu, and I'm part of the administration team. And Ms. Julie has asked me to stand up here before you all to inform you. So because of the person that I am, I need to say a little word of prayer because I'm nervous, and I may go back and sit down before I tell y'all anything, okay? All right, so just bear with me. Father God, I thank you, God. I praise you, Lord. I thank you for the word that was spoken through Mr. Black today about the agape love, Father God. And I pray, oh God, that we will seek you, oh God, to do better in the way that we love one another, Father. Father God, I pray for your strength, oh God, that you would speak through me, oh God. And Father, I pray for those that's listening, oh God. And Father, I pray that the Holy Spirit will cause us to be a call of action, Father, that we will come forth, oh God, and do as your word has told us to do. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All righty. So, like I said, Miss Judy asked me to stand up here and to just inform you all of what's going on in the body of Christ, particularly this local body. So first off, I just want to praise God that we are almost there with our air conditioning fund. So we're almost there. That's a good thing. But on the other hand, we are $25,000 behind in our budget. Yeah, $25,000 behind in budget. And we are seriously low in our reserve funds. What's our reserve fund used for? Glad you want to know, because I wanted to know that same question. And so these funds help pay our bills as well as our payroll. So we are going to dedicate Sunday, October the 31st, as a sacrificial Sunday in our giving. So we want to, first of all, you know, to thank you all. For those of you who pay your tithes, we thank you. For those of you who do your offering, we thank you. But we also want you to consider to go even beyond that. You know, we are a body of Christ that we believe in giving our tithes and offering. It's stated in Malachi 3. And also we know even before then, Abraham, you know, he did a tithe back in Genesis. So I just want to just share a little story with you from my childhood, how I became, learned to give, I guess. I was raised by my grandmother, and she was disabled, so she got a disability check. And so it was like two or three of my cousins that she raised, but every time we went to church, she made sure we had an offering in our hand. We did not go to church without an offering. And that offering, back in the day, so that was a lot of money still. My offering for Sunday school was 25 cents. My offering for passing the plate was 25 cents. And then we went around the table, so that was another 25 cents. So that was a pretty good amount of money. One particular day, I remember, and I was 10 years old, changed my entire life, totally changed my life. I was sitting beside this lady. She was probably my grandmother's age, but my grandmother was just disabled, so she couldn't work. But this lady, she did work, and she had grown children, and she had grandchildren, like my grandmother. So the offering plate was coming around. I had my 25 cents. This lady sat to my right. She was digging in her purse, and I saw dollar bill. I saw that, but she was still digging. And this lady brought up 15 cents and put in the offering plate. I tell you, that changed my life. I sat right there, and I know God give us the desires of our hearts. He put those desires there. I sat right there and say, God, when I get grown, I'm going to give back to you. And that's exactly what I do today. Have I fallen short sometimes? Sometimes I kept it. Absolutely. But do I make that a lifestyle to not give? No, I've always had that desire in my heart to give, not only to, you know, the body of church, but the people that's in need, period. I give. So what am I saying? I'm saying Sunday, mark your calendars, Sunday, October the 31st, we're asking you to go beyond your giving. And please consider 2 Corinthians, the ninth chapter, the 7th verse, where Paul talks about God loved a cheerful giver. So be in prayer for asking God, you know, what you should do. God would put it in your heart, lay it on your heart to do just that. But I take my seat and just to say thank you on the behalf of the administration team and all that you do. I'm a believer. Once you know better, you do better. So you have been served. Thank you.
Thank you, Debbie. Let's stand and let's sing Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know.